All right, welcome everyone, especially the new subscribers. We have to keep our pedal to the metal right now and continue as fast as possible to take in as much as possible. Now, what I have found in observing the world is the closer we get to major problems, major dust-ups in the world, the greater the defensiveness that arises. In other words, everyone's defense system is tightening. And because of that, it becomes more and more difficult to listen to what used to be fairly easy to listen to. What I'm giving out now is not that difficult to listen to, really. But under the circumstances, it's becoming more and more difficult. Very interesting dynamic. Of course, as one senses danger looming, defenses will spring into action and will tend to shut down. So therein is a troublesome dynamic. But I will continue to try to keep doing what I can do. The last video I spoke about the what-if game, and that we're not lost in time and space. We can continue on with that theme as a beginning point, where I said, for instance, if we make this one statement, the statement is, what if there were a million entanglements for me? To correct this, we don't have to try and correct a million entanglements. We only need to correct the statement, there is a million entanglements for me, and question that, is that statement true or not? And if it's untrue, then we don't have to undo any a million entanglements, because they're not there. This is what's called saving time. This is really the crux of spiritual teaching on a practical standpoint, is to save time and to recognize that one does not have to go about solving a million problems. Because when we fall into that trap, which I suppose all of us have, and myself, I certainly did, I saw so many problems. Everywhere I looked, I saw problems, and I tried to get myself geared up to solve all those problems, and it caused, you know, too much amplification and effort, and couldn't sleep anymore. Terrible insomnia, thinking, oh, I just have to keep thinking constantly, how do I solve these problems? How do I solve these problems? Terrible, terrible situation. Gradually been led out of that delusion and into checking to see, wait a minute, do we really have any problems at all? Or is this existence a what-if game? In other words, what if we did have these problems? What if reality did have these problems? And say, wait, before I go and try to solve the problems of the world, let me make sure that the original supposition, the original premise is true or false. Let me look at that original premise. And if we see, wait a minute, this isn't really our home, this isn't reality, this is a what-if hypothetical scenario. And then you say, yeah, but, you know, well, reality doesn't have any of these problems. So these problems don't need to be solved. What needs to be resolved is the premise that hypothetical what-ifs are actually false, and we don't need to continue to entertain them. So then really our only problem is just one little problem, one mad desire on our, and not endless millions of entanglements and problems at all, which is a tremendous relief. So in listening to those to these videos, if you're asking, you know, is there going to be any help here for me? Well, how helpful is it to realize that you only have one problem and not infinite problems? I would say that's the very essence of helpfulness, because that's what all these videos are geared towards, that recognition. That's what all spiritual teaching is geared towards. As long as we have the desire to change what we are, we're going to overlook the basic original statement premise that what if we had all this scenario, what if we had a world that was full of problems, that was the way that this world is, what if this was all the way reality was, what if reality was different? Basically, that's what we're saying. What if reality were different? We overlook questioning that premise, and we only look at what the difference might be and respond to what the difference might be if it were possible. We don't question whether it's possible or not. We take as a given what if it were possible. We say, okay, let's just imagine that it were possible. What would it be like? And then we respond to what we imagine it would be like. Literally, this universe, what we're seeing, what we're responding to, is imagination, our own imagination. And not human imagination, spiritual imagination, actually the imagination of mind. Mind's creativity being used for the purpose of imagination, producing images, stream of images, imagining. That's literally what we are responding to. And what spiritual teaching tells us is what we need to do is question the initial step of what if reality could be changed, and ask, is that, can it be changed? And if the answer is no, then what meaning does it have to be responding to all of these imaginations that we're responding to? Then we'll see very easily that it's all equally meaningless, which means we don't really need to have a response to it. We don't need to be responding to it. But we're so used to responding to what we're seeing outside of ourselves, projected in our imagination, that we need to substitute for that. And I say that's unconditional love, is we can see that instead and respond to that. So we don't have to give up responding, okay? Everyone, that's really what everyone's frightened of. They're frightened of giving up what they're so used to, which is responding to what they're perceiving. And they believe that if they stop responding to what they're perceiving, then that's death. They'd be dead. You know, the idea of being dead means no response, right? So we don't have to give up responding to what we're perceiving. We merely need to choose to respond to unconditional love, which is unchanging. The response is steady. It's not a lack of response. Just because a response is steady doesn't mean it's a lack of response. Okay? So don't get tripped up on that. Someone might claim that one who is responding to unconditional love and is in perfect peace, perfect calm, perfect stillness, that they're not responding at all. Not true. They're simply responding to an effect, which is unconditional love, which is unchanging, which is not being modified, which is steady, which is stable, which reminds us of reality. Reality, the nature of reality cannot be changed. And we need to be reminded of that. But we need to use response to an effect because we're addicted to that. It's a practical fact that we have become so habituated to responding to imagination that it feels like annihilation to us if we give up responding to something that we're perceiving. Reality actually is a matter of direct experiencing. So there's no responses taking place, it's direct experiencing. But we have been for so long caught up in responding to our imagination that we feel as if we, by jettisoning that, we would be annihilated. No response. We think there'd be no response. So we're terrified of it. That's why there's this intermediate step back to direct functioning the way we were created to function. And it's actually by choosing a different idea that this whole play of imagination and responding to imagination as if, what if reality could be changed, was based on our desire to be prime creator. In other words, to change what we are, to change what reality is. And so that's it came from that desire, that idea that we chose. We wanted to see if we could be prime creator. So what we do now is we choose the desire not to be prime creator, which means not to try and change reality. And the effect that arises from that is this, what I call the overlay, what can also be called unconditional love or perfect peace or seamless oneness. That's an effect of this idea. And then we respond to that effect. And but the response is smooth, steady, seamless. But it's still a response. And so we're in familiar territory. We're responding to an effect. instead of direct experiencing or responding to an effect. But the response is so, the effect is perfectly smooth and steady and unified and unchanging and pure. Therefore, our response is related to that. And therefore, we remember what reality is like. We get very close so that we can then take the final step, which is direct experiencing, which is not based on response at all. These are the basic ABC teachings of the highest teaching, of actual how it all works for us, how we can be redeemed from this horrible response to our imaginings, that reality is can be changed, can be altered, can be modified. Of course, we're responding to existence, which, what is that? Ceaseless modification, ceaseless change, ceaseless impermanence, ceaseless constructivity and destructivity. And we're constantly addicted to responding to that. And by doing so, we have a plausible belief and faith that reality can be changed and that we can be whatever we create. We can create ourselves. We can be prime creators. We can be the originator of a new reality. We can pretend that this is possible. We can believe it, have faith in it, and pretend. It's a vast pretense that we're engaged in. So instead of trying to struggle with all our responses to this imagining of impermanence, all we do is decide to respond to unconditional love, that effect. And boom, right there, our response is smooth, steady, and seamless. And there's no problem there whatsoever. It's effortless. And then we, by abiding in that response, we come to have a deep, deep familiarity with and remembrance of what we really are. And then the final step of direct experiencing becomes effortless for us, eventually. But we don't need to worry about that final step. It will automatically come. But the step we do need to be concerned about and focused on is getting to experience this unconditional love, responding to this effect. This effect is already here. It's not being generated by the world. It's not being generated by our imagination. It's being generated by mind in response to the idea of not trying to be prime creator. The mind automatically presents this. Mind is a servant of spirit. Mind presents ideas. I suppose you could say it is also imagination of mind, because it's not direct experiencing and it's being perceived, it's being responded to. But it's not imagination in the play of impermanence, it's imagination in the play of permanence, which is steady, effortlessly steady, exactly the same, all places, all times, all situations, infinitely and endlessly, unmodifiable, and the same quality, same intensity, perfect stillness, gentleness, peacefulness, pure awareness, total purity, no admixture. So we are way back to remembering what we really are and functioning as we were created to function is through abiding, responding to this effect. And again, the response is calm, peace, steady. And yet it is a response. So the fear that we have, again, is that because our responses are not variable, as all responses to the world are certainly variable because the effects of the world are extremely variable, we wrongly believe that somehow we'd be dead, like a dead person. Not true. We definitely are responding. Those who are abiding in that, responding to unconditional love, are responding to that. To what they see. It is a type of perception. It is a type of awareness or type of response. It's not a direct experiencing. Direct experiencing is even beyond that. It's beyond it. But it is a response. So we're not dead. If one is sitting there like a stone and doesn't seem to be responding to the world, that doesn't mean they're not responding to unconditional love. you see. All it means is that they're not responding to the world, but rather to unconditional love. But the response, perception response mechanism is still there, so they're still in familiar territory. The basic context is still familiar. All right? This is like a pearl of great price to hear this, because it's the very essence of we're touching upon our troubles. And satsang means one has to touch upon our troubles. Actually touch upon them. Otherwise, we're just spinning our wheels getting nowhere. We're just continuing to respond to the world, which gets us nowhere. We have to change what we respond to. And there's nothing in this world that can remind us, our response to that cannot remind us of what we are. Doesn't matter how beautiful you go on the most beautiful vacation somewhere. It will not remind us of what we are. You see a beautiful sunset on a beautiful beach in Hawaii. That will not remind us of what we are. It just gives us a pleasant response. Seems temporarily pleasant, vaguely pleasant. But then we go on to other responses, and they'll be all variable. We go back to our hotel and we can't sleep, the mattress isn't good, you know, the fruit is not ripe, we have to tip the maid, it's very expensive, and the neighbors are, the people in the hall are noisy, and we've got sunburn, you know, we've got some mosquito bites, and we're worried about what we're going to do tomorrow, and all sorts of variable responses are just start, you know, kicking around everywhere. We're a buzz with our responses to our imaginings that we call a world. So the only remedy is to respond to perfect peace, unconditional love. Respond to that. And we certainly can do it because many have done it throughout history. They've done it. And the way to do it is to touch upon any our reluctance. And again, much of that, you know, centers around kind of a irrational fear of, gee, if I'm not responding to the world, I must be dead. No. Because what are we doing when we're responding to the world? Our perception. There's a response. Our perception is responding. When we respond to unconditional love, our perception is also responding. Perceptivity is responding. When we, in this world, perceptivity is responding. Perceptivity. And again, with responding to unconditional love, our perceptivity is responding. Very much the same. Very close to being the same. Now, the mechanism of perception may be different in the case of unconditional love, because it's not perceptible by the senses of the body, but the mind is perceptible by the mind or by the spirit. The perception, there is a mechanism of perception. It can be perceived, can be responded to. We're responding to it. There's a response to it. We don't have to get rid of response. We don't have to get rid of perception. Don't have to get rid of the mind. Don't have to get rid of anything. Simply need to change what you're responding to. Okay, this is vastly easy. Spiritual practice, spiritual teaching, satsang, is not to make things difficult and complicated. It's to point out what the easy way is. It's to remind you, to tell you, to reassure you, there is an easy way. In fact, the only way that works is very easy. Very, very simple and very, very easy. Not difficult. It's the ego that tells you how difficult it all is. The ego tells you have to go out and somehow solve all the problems of the world so you're responding, your responses will be smoothed out. It's like the ego saying, yeah, all this stuff is bothering your response. So you need to somehow solve all these problems and bring peace to the world so your responses will be more smoothed out. And then you feel like you have an infinite task ahead of you. And if you really, really want redemption, you really want to remember what you are, and the ego gets a hold of you, which it does, then you will fall into depression and despair. because the task seems impossibly difficult to accomplish. I know I've been there, and I work 24 hours a day. My mind would never stop. I couldn't sleep at all. And so, you know, my take on insomnia, not being able to sleep, is very to the point. What you're literally trying to do is you're trying to reach salvation by solving all the problems of the world. That's exactly what I tried to do. So literally every day I was noticing everything that could be fixed. I kept trying to say, okay, now how can I fix this? How can I fix that? I see somebody who's sick. I say, well, how can I make them well? You know, all the problems. And of course, as the older I got, the more problems I saw, which means the more despondent I got, because I said, my gosh, this task is overwhelming. And so then my mind was going 24 hours a day, full speed, million miles an hour, just desperately trying to figure out, how can I solve all these problems? It's horrible. Horrible. Absolutely terrible. Insomnia is not a good thing. It's not anything to be sneezed at or laughed at. You really, really have to get a hold of teaching that addresses this problem. And I gradually got a hold of that, which is why I'm at where I'm at right now. In my case, I got a hold of it through A Course in Miracles, which is, if I hadn't got a hold of that, I wouldn't be here today. Because it, in its own way, it enabled me to recognize this central dynamic. Now, there are other ways you can get a hold of the situation too and recognize the central dynamic. But if you don't get a hold of it, your mind will continue to try to solve all the problems of the world. One of two things will happen. You'll give up any desire to be saved and remember what you are. Any desire towards enlightenment would have to be eventually abandoned or way toned down just be able to sleep and relax enough to function here. Or you'll take medication. That, in my case, no medication worked. My mind just kept going. Didn't matter what I took. Didn't matter. Couldn't slow it down. Couldn't stop it. Why? Because I was so intense on salvation, redemption, enlightenment. Because I knew what it was and I wanted it. I could not get rid of the desire. Impossible. So my mind would not stop. There's no medication strong enough, if you're in that condition, to stop your mind. Your mind will continue on. So basically then I said, forget it. You know, I've got to find the answer to this spiritually. And so that's when I grabbed a hold of A Course in Miracles back in 1978 and started to get a clue about what was going on. Started to have my own intuition validated. I knew intuitively what was going on, but the world invalidates your deep intuition. It invalidates it. The ego completely invalidates it. The ego tells you, when you try and drop solving all the problems of the world, the ego will insist that you're selfish, that you're lazy, you're selfish, and just rips into you. So it invalidates your intuition. A Course in Miracles did was validated my intuition, helped me clarify it and remember it, and then bring me to the point now where I can say, yeah, it's all about choosing a different effect to respond to. Because the whole purpose of responding to the world and all its problems is to continue a deep forgetfulness of what we are, so that we can pretend that we're something different. That's it. All these problems are arising just because of that. There isn't any other source of any of these problems. The impermanence and problems of the world arise from our desire to pretend to be prime creator. That's the only origin, the only source they have. It's the idea, it's our desire. I think Buddhism says desire is the root of all problems. That is true. It's our desire to be prime creator that gives rise to all this impermanence and change and misery and suffering and dying and death and sickness and difficulties, so that by responding to this, by perceiving and responding, we remain in a state of extreme forgetfulness of what we really are, extreme forgetfulness of what reality really is. Therefore, we can pretend, imagine, believe, and have faith in that we are prime creators, or can become prime creator. Because if we know what we are, we couldn't possibly believe or have faith in such a thing, because we would know directly what we are. There's no space, no possibility of pretending otherwise. But only by through this vast imagining and responding to this imagining of impermanence are we able to be in the state of forgetfulness, so we can pretend that we could be something other than what we are. These are the core basic teachings. And it's a privilege to be able to share these. And this has not come easily. I'll tell you that. Not at all. It's only come about through tremendous long-term work of validating, you know, what I know within. Because again, the world is a place of invalidation. It tries to invalidate remembering what we are. It really is. Some speak about the world as if there's an adversary here. And of course, they call it the ego or something. But the adversary is our own desire to pretend to be something different than what we are. And that desire markets itself, presents itself with all this impermanence and response to this impermanence. And we call that the ego or the devil or the adversary or whatever. That's just a way of referring to actual the playing out of our own desire to be other than what we are. So we don't even really need to use those terms. You can even get past using the term ego, all those terms. We can simplify it to the point that it's not even necessary to talk like that. And simplifying it, it becomes much easier to see. Simply change the effect we're responding to. Choose unconditional love as the effect we respond to. And that's it. Because if we don't do that, we will continue to struggle in the mire, to be bogged down in a swamp, to be faced with insurmountable odds. And our defense against that will be to lower our expectations. And what I have seen as we progress towards what's called the end times, time of troubles, time of instability in the cosmos, especially in this solar system. And on this planet, and within our culture and civilization, within our lives, we have lowered the bar of expectations more and more and more and more and more, so we don't feel overwhelmed. Because if we kept the bar of expectations high, like we expect to solve all the problems of the world so we can be saved, we would be overwhelmed. So everyone's lowering the bar more and more and more. Maybe we don't realize it, but I can guarantee you in observing a situation that this is what's happened. And that is why there's less response in the world to spiritual teaching like this. Because people are not looking for it. They're looking much, much lower. But the few that are able to look, still look at this level, that's really a tremendous accomplishment. It means you haven't lowered the bar down, which means you're still holding out hope that, you know what, I can be saved from, I can be enlightened, I can be self-realized. I can be saved. I can be redeemed. It is possible. I can experience true happiness. You still have the bar there. And the only way to keep it there, again, is some intuition within you is telling you, hey, you know what? It's actually very simple. I only need to respond to another effect, the effect of unconditional love. I can respond to that. I don't have to solve the problems of the world. Because if we, as soon as we believe that we have to solve the problems of the world in order to be saved, we'll be overwhelmed, because the problems of the world are growing exponentially. Truly. And this is why I'm giving these satsangs. I came here to do this, because I knew ahead of time what was going to happen with the world, that the problems would grow exponentially, and that if we don't have genuine satsang here pointing out the truth, that we are saved simply by responding to the effect of unconditional love, instead of trying to respond to the world and solve the problems out there. If we don't have that, we are going to lower the bar of expectations or be overwhelmed by the problems. So it's a crucial, crucial time. And if things are playing out exactly as foreseen, the problems that are to come soon, I'd say that in July of 2012, is going to ratchet up again. Whole nother level of turmoil and problems. And if we don't have this satsang here, where it's being pointed out the simple truth of how to beat the entire system by simply responding to a different effect, instead of responding to the impermanence of the world, the dance of delusion of the world, respond to the effect of unconditional love, the idea of not trying to change reality. Instead of responding to the effects of the idea of trying to change reality, we respond to the effect of the idea of not trying to change reality. So our perception response mechanism is still in place. We're just changing what we're responding to. If we don't have that teaching here and we're not hearing it, and we're still believing that we have to somehow solve the problems of the world, as this world and the stability of this world spins out of control, we will be pulled into despair and be overwhelmed. And then the defenses against that are, you know, varied. Medication, people up their medication, drugs, too much sex, too much drugs, suicidal feelings, despondency, the whole thing of just desperately trying to shut the mind down, and the mind frantically tries to wrap itself around all the changes that are happening. You can easily see a scenario where you're sitting there immersed in internet pornography, taking drugs, drinking, smoking pot, taking whatever drugs you're taking, and just trying to go into a stupor, you know, a fantasy stupor of trying to keep control over your mind. That will happen if you don't have access to satsang, if you're not clued into it, if you don't hear that all you need to do is respond to a different effect instead of the world. Then when the change ratchets up and becomes extreme, as it will very soon, you are really going to be in severe trouble. The mind will get frantic on you, and then you will frantically try desperate measures to calm the mind down. And those desperate measures, again, will cause you to act out in many ways. You know, as they say, people will start having panic sex all over. That type of thing. Panic drugs, panic music, panic sex. There'll just be this massive, you know, wild atmosphere in the world of people trying to calm their minds down. And if you're caught up in that, then you'll get pulled into all that. If you don't have the key, you'll get pulled into all of that. Regretfully. I'm not judging any of that. I'm just telling you the dynamics of it, what will happen. And so I've seen all of this ahead of time. Looked at all of it, see it all, and I'm telling you, bringing the satsang to the world through YouTube. And hopefully there'll be more subscribers, because it's important. It's extremely important. Because of this dynamic I'm pointing out, as change accelerates, again, if you believe your salvation depends on solving the problems of the world, as change accelerates, you'll fall into extreme despair and a desperate attempt. Your mind will start going faster and faster and seem out of control. I've already been through this. And the mind spins, feels like it's out of control. You sit there and you feel you can't do anything about it. Because it's racing, trying to wrap itself around, trying to come up with some kind of resolution to all the problems we're having, thinking that it has to do that in order to find peace of mind. And I'm telling you for sure, it doesn't have to do that. All you need to do is choose a different effect to respond to. That's all anyone has to do. No exceptions. So I am very grateful to be able to present these satsangs to the world. And absolutely believe in what I'm doing. And in talking about this in the way that I'm presenting it, telling you, yes, is supremely important now to hear this simple truth. You are saved by choosing to respond to unconditional love, a different effect than the impermanence of the world. Your response, your perception in response is still there. You're in familiar territory. You won't be a zombie. You won't be a stone. Your response is powerful. It's pure. It's strong. It's still there. You're still responding. But it's steady. And you won't get pulled into the crazy party. We might think, yeah, there's some big party going to come up in the world, which is true. But it's a crazy party. It's like an orgy. Of wild acting out, of people desperately trying to get control of their minds and slow them down and steady themselves, trying all sorts of different ways. And you have to ask yourself, is that what you really want? Because it's really actually horribly frightening. And you end up wiped out and still nowhere. The mind is still all freaking out. See, as we go along with normal change, the mind keeps thinking that it can handle it. It's still saying, you know what, okay, I can sleep tonight, and tomorrow I'll work on it. But when change accelerates and when turmoil becomes extreme, the mind starts freaking out, guaranteed. And those who are still trusting in some way to control the mind are parking up the wrong tree, and they will find themselves spinning out of control and then grasping at straws. But those who are listening to this satsang are finding some other satsang, some other teaching that gives them the truth. They won't be spinning out of control like that. They'll say, oh, no, wait a minute. No. All I have to do is find a different effect to respond to. Effect of unconditional love that's steady, that's unchanging, that's unmodifiable. And that is the answer, because that reminds me of what I am. I don't need to send my mind in response to what's taking place in the world. That's not the way. That's the way to what they say is damnation. What meaning? Panic. When the mind races out of control due to too much change too fast, a panic sets in. And when panic sets in, one begins to behave in ways, unexpected ways, that they would not otherwise behave. One becomes tremendously vulnerable to grasping at straws, of desperately trying to find some way to calm the mind down, to slow it down, which end up ruining your nerves, ruining your health, pulling you down even worse, and things get blacker and blacker and blacker, more and more despair. I'm absolutely positive of this because I've been there and done that. So I'm not just hypothetically talking about this. This is how it works. And I'm not just trying to use the times, to get attention. I'm actually sharing how it works. And I don't want people to go down that road because I know what the road is like. Terrible. Can't stop the mind. The mind is racing. It's horrible because you lie there, you can't sleep, your nerves get burned out. Everything, you feel so horribly tired and fatigued. It's awful. So this satsang is for a purpose, and whatever attention comes here, it's for the purpose of helping you not get pulled down into that. I'm already aware of this, see. But this awareness is fine for me, but it needs to be shared. So again, we go over it. And over and over and over and over it. There's a purpose why this is being done. And people say, why are you whispering or speaking quietly? Well, there's neighbors, you know, 50 feet away. There's a family of neighbors busily about their business, and there's people busy walking their dogs and moving out front here, just in the front yard, in the street. There are people all around. You know, maybe they don't want to hear about this right now. So this is on the down low. We're not shouting it from the rooftops. But still, it needs to be spoken of. And it must be spoken of. It's vitally important because there are those in this world who want to be self-realized, who want to be enlightened, who want to wake up, who want to remember what they are, remember their reality, remember their true identity. And they are in a very difficult situation because if they don't latch on to truth, they'll end up desperately trying to lower their expectations just to stop their mind from racing. And then they'll get into all sorts of quote-unquote spirituality, psychic stuff. And that is really bad news. They'll also get into, you know, desperately trying to stop the mind from racing. And the combination of ways to try and deal with that, that all of them are very bad news. Completely miss the boat. It's lowering expectations way, 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 way down. So you lose sight of the prize altogether. And losing sight of the prize altogether, then you think, well, I only need to solve maybe a little few problems. Not have to solve all the problems of the world. But if you keep your bar of expectations where it has to be, and yet you are still uncertain about how to be saved, how to be self-realized, you will think you have to solve all the problems of the world, all of them. And of course, you can't do that. And the more things suddenly change, the more the mind gets thrown all out of whack. So it's vitally important for those who want to be self-realized to find some satsang now that gives them the right reminder, and they can relate to it. Whatever it is, doesn't have to be this one, it could be any one, doesn't matter to me. But it's very important that they find some clear exposition of truth right now. And then get a hold of that and keep getting a hold of it. Keep hearing it, keep reinforcing it, and keep hearing, okay. What we need to do is not solve all the problems of the world that we're responding to. We need to respond to a different effect, a different imagining of unconditional love, which has no problems, therefore has no need to solve anything. Simply abide, respond in a joy and happiness and calm to that effect. Our response is one of calm and peace as we respond to that effect. Whereas, if we keep responding to the world, our response will be one of supreme agitation coming up. Supreme agitation. Do not trust that the future of this planet will be one that will enable you to have less and less agitation as you respond to it. It's not so. The agitation is going to get worse and worse and worse. And the mood of agitation in the world is going to exponentially increase. So do not gamble on that at all. That will be a disaster for you. And even if things stay the same or whatever, still we're still caught up in this, the same problem of believing we have to solve all the problems of the world, which is impossible. All the problems of the cosmos. All the impermanence. It's ridiculous. So, the same teaching holds true always in existence. Right now it is a crisis point, so it's vitally important. Take it seriously. Vitally important that the essential, simple teaching is heard, and that something in you registers it. Say, oh yeah, okay, I'm hearing it now. Now I'm hearing it. Very simple. We have very active neighbors. Oh my gosh, they're in and out constantly. Very good people. Very active. The truth is, we can only remember what we are. We're going to respond to an effect which is not trying to change what we are. Not by responding to an effect, to effects which are trying to change what we are. We can't remember what we are in that way at all. And we cannot respond to the impermanence of the world and then try to solve the problems of the world and think that is somehow going to remind us of what we are. That just doubles the delusion. Because even in the changing of the effects, that doesn't remind us of who we are. Even in the healing, that's a change, isn't it? Let's say something's really sick and then it gets better. We're still responding to a change in something. And that keeps us in deep forgetfulness of what we are. Because what we are is not sick at all. It does not change at all. None. The only way we can remember what we are is to respond to an effect which is unchanging. It has no need of healing. No need of change of any kind. And that's this seamless vision of oneness, this perfect peace, this pure awareness, this unconditional love, that effect, unchanging. And so our response is so peaceful and calm. But still, a profound response is there. It's just steady. And others of the world will mock it, say, ah, it's like you're dead. What are you doing? How come you're not responding to all the problems in the world? How come you're not out there trying to solve the problems of the world? You must be very self-absorbed, very selfish, and blah, blah, blah. On and on it goes, trying to invalidate, you know. Which is why, perhaps, there will be places for those who choose to respond to unconditional love to go, where they won't be invalidated. The invalidation of this world is going to become profound. It's already monstrously strong here. Incredible. It's amazing that these videos get the validation that they do, but I know it's not easy for people because they're being tugged and pulled and pushed, and you know, the demand in this world is invalidate truth. That's what the ego is putting the pressure on us. The ego tells us, you gotta go out and respond to the world. What's going on? Respond to it and try to solve it. Respond to what's happening. Try to solve it. That's the ego. That's delusion. That's what keeps you enslaved to forgetfulness of what you are. And so, of course, the ego wants to invalidate anything that says otherwise. Otherwise, it'd be out of a job. You know, just trying to keep its job, so to speak. That's just a colorful way of speaking. But what we're really trying to do is keep our desire, keep our pretense that we can be prime creator. We want to keep that pretense. Because we feel like we haven't really explored it completely. Well, guess what? We can never explore it completely because we can never experience it. And we're just deluding ourselves by saying we haven't explored it completely. No, there is no completeness to explore. There is no such experience of us being prime creator. Just a pretense. We have explored pretending completely. Thoroughly. Because it's all just flat. There's nothing really to explore at all. It's all meaningless. So we have a priori explored it already. We just keep thinking that we haven't. We keep thinking there must be more. There isn't. There's no more to it. When you experience total flatness, total meaninglessness, there is no more to it. But we can always pretend like, well, there must be something more. There has to be. So we got to keep looking. Got to keep searching. We can always, you know, say that. And keep at it. But it gets us nowhere. So I make these videos, the satsang, long. Because it's so important to keep re-emphasizing. Maybe you won't hear it the first 10 times, or the first 20 times, or the first 100 times. But one of these times, you're going to hear it. And you'll suddenly say, oh my gosh, it's completely simple and easy. Oh my gosh, and you're going to, you might be frightened to say, holy cow, I've been standing on the edge of an abyss here. The abyss of trying to respond to the world and solve all my responses to what's happening in the world, try to smooth all those out, trying to iron all those out. That's an absolute abyss of infinite effort and struggle and misery. And I've been standing on that abyss. Holy cow. And then you realize, I just take one step back, and I'm no longer on the edge of that abyss. Just take a step back. So it's kind of, it can be startling, really. Sure, startling. Like, wow, I've been considering, you know, insanity. I've been, but you know, don't fear it. That's normal to be startled by it. You see the grave consequences of the situation, of making a mistake, and remaining deluded. Grave consequences as far as misery and suffering. And there's no misery or suffering worse than the belief you have to solve everything, because then your mind just races out of control. You can't sleep, and your nerves become completely exhausted, and nothing is enjoyable. You're like a zombie almost. You feel like a walking dead person. There's nothing worse than that. So literally, you're on the abyss of that. But at the same time, you say, oh, but I can step back from this. Okay. It's not as bad as I thought. And satsang is really a way of stepping back, taking baby steps. The big step is to simply decide to respond to unconditional love. Once that step is taken, then no more steps need to be taken. That's it. But satsang is like baby steps shuffling back from the abyss. There's always an abyss, trying to solve all the world's problems. That this dynamic is always there, but it's going to become unmanageable. We always have a sense we can manage it somehow, but for many it will become unmanageable, especially those who think they have to solve all the problems, who are trying to be enlightened. It will become unmanageable to remain oriented towards solving the world's problems, because clearly things will become chaotic and it will say, it's unsolvable, I can't see how to manage this at all. We all have some managing techniques. We think we can manage it. And delusion has to have that, or else, again, it will spin out of control and go into severe depression. So we keep ourselves from getting severely depressed by believing we have some management tools to manage the situation and find a way to... So we think, well, there's going to be some way to solve these problems. I can see a way to manage it. But when things spin out of control and the change becomes so ferocious, we realize, whoa, my techniques, my management techniques, it's not going to work. And if I don't have those, I've got no hope. It's hopeless. I'm never going to get a hold of this. I can't see a way to get a hold of it. And the mind will just frantically search for a way to get a hold of it, some kind of management techniques. Well, maybe we'll read constantly, desperately search, you know, for some sort of super management guru who will teach us how to manage all this stuff. And those kind of gurus, management gurus, will pop up all over the place like mushrooms, trying to take advantage of the situation. And people will rush to them and say, you know, what do I do? How can I manage all this situation and stuff? But if you've heard satsang, real true satsang, which is like is being presented here, you won't be vulnerable to that. You'll say, no. I already know the answer. I simply need to choose a different effect to respond to. The effect arises from the idea of not trying to change reality. That effect will be perfectly calm and still, unchanging. It's right here, right now, that effect. Actually, what we say, the Holy Spirit, which is part of it, which is one with what we are, it's an aspect of our spirit, Holy Spirit, has already chosen that idea for us. It's already been chosen, already been selected as the remedy. So the effect is already here within us. It's already there. It's been there from the very beginning of when we chose to try and change reality. Immediately, simultaneously with that, the Prime Creator saw that our spirit chose the idea of not trying to change reality and not trying to become something different than what we are. So that effect of unconditional love has been with us from the very beginning. It's with us right now, will always be with us. So it's within us. So we can choose to perceive it and respond to that. and that will save us from the misery of the mind frantically spinning out of control and not realizing that its management techniques can't be really be applied to what's going on anymore. So I'm sure that many of you hearing this know exactly what I'm talking about. You know, it's an open secret. And many have had warnings about the future, which is why they're listening to the satsang in the first place. Because they realize that, yeah, things are going to get wild here. Change is going to sweep the globe. All sorts of stuff. It's going, all sorts of change on all sorts of levels is going to take place now. Beyond what we have expected or anticipated, really, as I said, cosmic changes. Changes with our sun. Those changes will affect us profoundly. Changes in financial systems, changes in social systems, changes in everything. Gigantic changes to our whole sense of what we're used to. And so our techniques of trying to remain stable and getting some sleep at night, those go out the window. And with nothing else to grab a hold on, people will grab at straws again, as I pointed out, and people will get into all sorts of crazy behavior. Try to deal with it. Try to deal with the horrible panic of the mind. The mind will panic and just race. Go to bed at night, lie there, and the mind's, you just look at the mind, it's go click, 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 just like a vast supercomputer just racing top speed, and you can't shut it off. And you just sit there like you're being victimized by this. And you say, mind, I'm not getting any sleep. My nerves are fried. I'm exhausted. You gotta slow down. Mind's not listening. Doesn't respond. And then you start lowering the bar of expectations and grab a hold of some medication, grab a hold of something, self-medicate, medication, all sorts of ways to self-medicate, aren't there? All sorts of ways. All sorts of ways to get crazy. Try to drown out the mind's, you know, panic. So this is real talk about troubles. That we need not succumb to because we can sidestep them. Choose to respond to a different effect other than the world. The world is just an effect. It's an imagining. It's like a movie. Let's say you're watching a movie and you also have a smartphone and the movie is just getting gory and frightening and wretched and wicked and horrible and catastrophic, and you're saying, wow, my responses are just out of control. This movie is horrible. My mind is off. I'm freaked out. What do I do? Now let's say you on your smartphone, you go to YouTube and you select this satsang here, one of these satsangs, you know, this one or some other, that, and you suddenly start watching this and paying attention to that. And you feel yourself calming down. And you say, whoa, wait a minute, I can be in control. There is a way for my mind not to be out of control. And so you're not paying any more attention to the movie on the screen. Sure, you know it's still taking place and you hear the sounds, but it's in the background, it's very vague. You're not really responding to it anymore. And you find, you suddenly feel centered again. And you say, hey, no, I'm not out of control. I have real hope. I realize I can pay attention to this. I can respond to a different effect. See, this is just an analogy, sort of a little allegory setting things up to show you that it's possible. In this world, it is possible to choose a different effect to respond to. Not only is it possible, it's essential. And, you know, very soon, we are going to hit the wall in this world. Very soon. Tensions are going to ratchet up. And we know the players. Some of them. We know the son's a player. We know various countries are players. We know various financial situations are players. We know various political figures are players. Various ideologies are players. We know there's a lot of players on the stage right now. And we have a very good idea of how those players are going to act. We've seen, you know, the play, we've got the gist of it. You know, we know, okay, I've seen this actor. I know how they're going to act. You know, we understand their character, their role, right, in this drama of existence. This drama of impermanence and change. This drama of responding to that impermanence and change and thereby remaining in forgetfulness of what we are. We understand that. So when we see these players on the stage, we have to say, uh-oh. We have a very good idea of the song and dance that they're going to put on. And we can say, you know what? That's going to really cause me a lot of problems. I'm not going to be able to wrap my management skills around that. My mind is going to spin out of control. So I better get a hold of satsang. Better get a hold of the simple truth. Simple truth. Truth is very simple. What we need to do is very simple. Simply respond. Choose to respond to a different effect. The effect of permanence. Not the effect of impermanence, the play of impermanence. Of course, if we're going to choose impermanence, that has to be a play, right? It has to be duality. If there's only a singular effect, how could there be impermanence? How could there be a play of impermanence? Could not be. So I always say it's a play of constructivity and destructivity that produces the play. It's a duality produces this play of impermanence. If there was only death, destruction, it would not be a play at all. There would be nothing. Nothing would be moving at all. It would be all dead. So it has to be constructivity, forms, that are, and then these forms moving around and being buffeted around and eventually dying in a constant change and impermanence. Whereas unconditional love is a singular effect. It's not a dualistic situation. It's singular. There's no change. There's no dance. There's no play. It's not playing. It's not dancing. It's reposing in perfect stillness and gentleness. Just one effect. Not a dualistic, dynamic effect of impermanence. So we choose that singular effect and respond to that singular effect. And we're no longer responding to the frantic, dualistic effect of existence, of impermanence, of change. Destructivity, of conflict, impermanence, constant change. We're no longer responding to that. We're not denying it. We're not responding to it, see? From a practical standpoint, we can respond to it just simply from a practical standpoint. Of course, we still drive our cars skillfully. But we do not respond to it from the standpoint of trying to solve the problems of it. That we see. We're not responding to it that way. But if we need to do something, we'll do it. But it's not coming from a standpoint of, I need to permanently solve this problem. If there's a traffic jam, you know, when you're in a traffic jam, you don't think, you know, somehow I've got to solve the problem of traffic jams. I've got to make it better because this is, you know, irritating me. It's a problem. You don't respond to that at all. You don't respond to the problems of the world as problems. You just respond as, this is what is. This is what is right now. But I don't need to change it in any way. Because I'm responding to a singular effect that is unchanging. And I know this is reminding me of what I am. So satsang can get into all of this core stuff easily. It's not difficult. It's not difficult for me to say these things. The difficulty comes because the ego wants to invalidate all this. It's not difficult to say it, but it's difficult to withstand the pressure of invalidation. Somewhat troublesome. You know, it's there. So, okay, this is very, very good. Very great. And I've conveyed what I need to convey right now. And next satsang will convey what needs to be conveyed right then. And we continue on with the pedal to the metal. And hopefully there will be new subscribers. I'd like to see more subscribers, because I know there's a lot of people, a lot of those out there who want enlightenment, self-realization, remembrance of their true identity. And they could be helped greatly by what is being said here. And hopefully they will find their way here and subscribe and get a hold of this teaching and have it and know it within and be validated. Everyone knows deep within this is true, this is so. But it's the invalidation of the world which causes such a problem. So it's supremely important to have this deep intuition validated. That's absolutely crucial. And if we feel invalidated, then things will get very tough for us. So those who are capable of validating our deepest intuition and truth and knowing that all we have to do is choose a different idea, a different effect to respond to, those need to come forth and help out right now. It's very important. And that's what's happening right here. Okay, very great. That's it for this video. That's it for this satsang. That's it for this validation.